creating cities that use less transport, less space, and less energy is a key sustainability challenge, not only in Finland, but in all countries around the world. Organizing our cities differently can help us to reduce the need for transport and encourage much more walking and cycling. This can help to reduce many of the negative environmental and social impacts of transport. Today, transport consumes large and increasing amounts of energy, land, and other resources, which results in impacts like climate change, noise pollution, and traffic accidents. As well as this, our transport choices have important impacts on our own levels of physical activity, health, and well-being. A large part of transport's environmental impact comes from using vehicles like cars, trains, planes, and ferries. But this is not the only way in which transport affects society and the environment. The manufacture of vehicles also adds to transport's large environmental impact. So too does the construction of all the infrastructure that is needed to accommodate vehicles. And crucially, the type and amount of this infrastructure that is built can affect the future demand for transport. Cities currently cover around 2.5% of the world's land mass, and transport infrastructure occupies a very big part of this. Anywhere between a quarter and half of the surface area of our cities is taken up by transport, depending on how transport intensive the city is. This means that the world's urban transport infrastructure occupies an area equivalent to somewhere between 3 and 6 times the landmass of Finland. And this infrastructure not only includes structures for accommodating moving vehicles, like roads and railways, it also includes all the structures for accommodating stationary vehicles, like car parks and railway depots. Paradoxically, while levels of education, sanitation, and employment tend to improve as economies grow, transport problems tend to become worse. But this doesn't mean that the same trend has to continue into the future. There are ways that we can address these problems. One important way of promoting more sustainable patterns of urban development is integrating transport with other types of land uses, like homes, offices, and shops. And this allows us to make more efficient use of the Earth's limited resources, especially land, energy, and raw materials. Integration can also help us to create more attractive cities in which to live and in which to work. Integrating transport and other land uses can simultaneously reduce the need for transport and increase the efficiency of the transport infrastructure. Three aspects of integration are crucial. The first is the combination of mutually supporting land uses in the city. Locating complementary land uses close to each other can reduce the need to travel long distances for everyday activities. A simple example here is the location of houses, offices, shops, parks, and schools within close proximity of each other. A mixture of land uses can reduce transport demand, especially when the development of density is high. And higher density not only makes more efficient use of land, it also increases the viability of local businesses and local services. Now, it's important to make a distinction here between high density and high rise. High development densities can be achieved without towers. High densities can be achieved without reducing green space or adding to the heat island effect of cities. The second main aspect of integration is linking urban land uses with transport infrastructure. And this means locating new urban development in areas that are accessible and well connected to space efficient and energy efficient transport systems. Higher development densities are also important for keeping travel distances short and close enough to reach by bike or by foot. The design of streets and transport infrastructure is also very important. Infrastructure that is direct, attractive, safe, and offers some protection from either heat or cold will help to increase its popularity and its use. Even small changes in the transport system can make a difference for how people choose to travel. For example, children are much less likely to be brought to school by car if nearby streets are closed to vehicles at the beginning and the end of the school day. And encouraging children to cycle and to walk to school isn't only good for their health and well-being, it also helps to shape the travel habits of future generations. The third key aspect of integration is making sure that different transport modes and their infrastructure connect properly with each other. This requires physical integration. In other words, making sure that infrastructure connects between different modes of transport and across city boundaries, so that journeys which combine different modes of transport are not only possible, but are easy and attractive. Simple improvements like signposting and onboard announcements can also help. My research is about the policies and plans that help cities and regions to achieve better integration between transport and other land uses. More specifically, my research is about the combinations of policies that can be used and the extent to which policies can be transferred from one city to another, recognizing that what works well in one place doesn't always work so well in another. The issue of governance, or how decisions are made and by whom, is central to this research. Of course, achieving integration between transport and other land uses is much easier said than done, but we really need to find new solutions. City planners and transport professionals increasingly need to work together to develop plans and projects that make integration of transport and other land uses actually happen in practice. The environmental, social, and health benefits are simply too high to ignore. Thank you for listening.